today will be more of a restorative type. So please have a blanket, a pillow, just grab something. Doesn't have to be fancy, doesn't have to be, any what we call proper yoga props. But if you do have a bolster, you can use it. I'll give you a moment or two to gather it. And the beauty about restorative or yin practice is that you don't need to accommodate yourself in any special way. You can stay in bed if you're still there. You can move to the sofa, to the couch, or unroll your mat and get to the floor. But it is a very supported type of practice, and it's good for everybody. You don't have to be in a yoga shape, because we do work more with the mind and with the breath than with the physical body. So, and it is yoga portion, and we'll get to it in a moment, but for now, we'll start with an open heart pose. So have either a blanket or a pillow somewhere in the upper portion of the mat or the sofa or your bed, and that elevated prop will be under the heart. Shoulders are on the ground, and you can adjust it according to the height that works for you. So if you have a lot of mobility in the spine, you can have it a little bit higher. If you have less mobility, a little bit shallower, and you can always have another blanket or a pillow under your head. So just give yourself enough time to come to the pose. So again, shoulders towards the ground, heart is a little bit lifted. Play with the location of the blanket or the pillow under the heart. I like it a little bit lower. It just feels better on my back. And then legs can be straight. You can keep the feet on the ground, maybe even come into Baddha Konasana, the time angel bind pose. And again, always an option to support the knees here. Another good way to approach it is knock the knees towards each other. That brings a lot of relaxation to the lower back. And once you hit that sweet spot, you can close your eyes and bring your attention inward. Rest it on the breath. Maybe bring it to open your heart. Tune in. A good way to approach restorative onion practice is by placing the attention on the senses. Listening to the music in the background, listening to my voice. Maybe you can hear something coming from outside the room you practice in. Noticing maybe the taste in your mouth. Maybe you are able to smell something. Feel the sensations against your skin, of your clothes, of the surface that you are lying on, different textures, different temperatures. And with your eyes closed, you can use your internal vision again just to observe what's going on. And talking about seeing, about looking, that will bring us to our yoga portion this morning, which is Re'e. In English translating, see or look. And in this portion, Moses clearly and explicitly present the only two options that the Israelites have. Either follow God's way and be blessed, or turn to worship other gods and be cursed. So there are no gray areas. There are no half kosher or kosher style. It's either this or that. And talking about kosher, he details and reminds his people of what they're allowed to eat, what is kosher, and what is forbidden for them to consume, to eat. So I thought about it in the way that being vegetarian for maybe 40 years, and my version of veganism in the last year or so, how we create to ourselves eating restrictions and eating rules, and which became very popular in the last probably decade or so. High protein, low carbs, no sugar, gluten free, and all those trends that we adapted to seek maybe healthier, better life. And again, I'm not coming to it from place of judgment or trying to persuade someone to do something, but just something to think about it. Maybe sometimes we go to some extremity with this and forget to really enjoy life and be healthy in the broader sense. So that one part of the portion this morning, and again maybe look at how you live, what are your choices, not just in the food aspect, but in life. When things are stated clearly to you, this is how you should do things or how you shouldn't do things, and where you find yourself in the framework. So, and just I want to remind you that everything that I say, everything that I present is my point of view, is how I understand it. But the practice is yours, and you should take it where you want to take it. So if all you want to do is lie and listen and ignore maybe my words, enjoy the background music, do that. If you just want to, you know, go about your day and have me in the background, that's also practice. So from here, from your back, we're going to a twist. So all you need to do is roll onto the right side, and again, it's your choice to keep that blanket or pillow under the side body, and maybe keep your head resting on the pillow. Maybe you want to bring it between your knees. It feels really nice. Then rest the head on the arm. So twists are very good for your digestion systems. That's probably the only way we can exercise our internal organs. And again, just close your eyes again. So once you find that sweet spot, and it takes a moment or two to adjust, so play with your props. Because one thing in restorative practice, you want to be completely supported and completely rested. And then again, let go. Completely surrender here to gravity, let it pull you down. Oh, that blanket is not feeling great on my side body. I'm going to bring it under my head. Find the right place to put your hands, maybe alongside the body, maybe resting on the floor. If you have another blanket, maybe you have the hand rest on the blanket. And again, just close the eyes and bring your attention inward. Feel your breath moving in, moving out.
notice what you're hearing.
And the objective is, in restorative, is to work with the mind and let it find peace and let it find space. Which is much more challenging than working with the body. Rarely we are letting ourselves to completely let go. Especially in these times where a lot of us are under deep stress about we worry more, probably more than usual. There are a lot of fear, uncertainty. And we don't really let us just be, just experience being still and tuned to us, to ourselves. Try to find, that maybe for a split second, that place where you are able to put aside all the noise and listen to your breath, listen to your heart beating. And once you notice that your mind is starting to get busy again, you're getting involved again, instead of fighting it, just let it happen. But try not to get carried away by your thoughts. Let them happen, let them be, and then let them go. So the essence of restorative practice or meditation is not to stop thinking. That won't happen, that is impossible. The practice is how we deal with the thinking process. Are we getting carried away? Are we getting too involved with our thoughts? Or we let them happen and then come back to the breath, come back to the heart that is beating, to the body, to the physical presence of our body. So from here, return onto your back, return to the middle between, or the center between right and left. And then roll onto your left side. And again, be aware that this side is maybe very different to your right side, and it needs a whole different support system. So move a little bit, wiggle a little bit, and then try to settle back into stillness.
device, whatever it is.
And you need to pay attention more to listening. Okay, so just to show you again, on the left side body, find comfort here. Hold silent, hold still. And just a process of tuning in into your body, to that container that holds the whole of you. So, in this weekly portion, the more significant, the more I think important part of the portion is the setting of laws and foundation for the society that the Israelites are about to build in the new land, and that future society will be a very moral one, a very equal, a very just one. The command is that there won't be needy or poor people in the society. It's our responsibility to care for everyone and everybody. To give everyone an equal chance to succeed. I know it all sounds very familiar, right? It's nothing new to us. And another law that is going to take or to be instated in that new society is the law of Shemitah, which is letting go. So every 7 years, there'll be a full remission of debts. All slaves will be freed. And so let's change position here, just to keep equal right and left. So from here, roll onto your belly and have either your pillow on or your blanket now under your lower belly and upper hips. So the softer the support is, the nicer it is. A little bit of elevation of that middle section of the body, and you can stack the hands one on top of the other. Bring the legs either wider apart with the toes turning out, or maybe closer together with the toes turning in. You can keep the forehead resting on the hands, a little bit of pressure, very delicate pressure on the forehead, again, that place of intuition, internal vision, your third eye, and that will send some, you know, will send waves of relaxation through the whole body. You can also hear on your belly, feel the breath moving in, moving out. Maybe you can even feel your heart beating. But you have an option to turn the head right or left. And I'll let you know about halfway through if you want to turn the head to the other side. And find peace here, find, again, that place where you can completely let go. In restorative yoga, more than probably in other yoga practices, let the practice come to your body. So don't push the body into the pose that you think you should practice. Give it all the support, all the hold that it needs to find that point, that place where things loosen up, or open up, which is not just in the physical aspect of the practice, it's in the emotional aspect of it, in the mental aspect of it, and maybe in the spiritual aspect of the practice. So as you hear on your belly, now something to think about as how you want to see your society, and what kind of society you want to live, and I find it really inspiring and aspiring that in the in this portion, it's not all. Just that command to set all the slaves free after 7 years. It's also that you're not letting them leave your house empty-handed. You have to share with them some of your wealth, so they are not thrown to the street to starve. They have something to start the new life with. And it's a strong command. And in this portion, in the previous portion that we talked about, that constant reminder that we were slaves in Egypt and now we are free people, and we should never forget it, because the line between being slave and being free is very fine. And I think yoga in a way that we should practice being good people, being just people, be moral people, and hope to live in a better society, because then we'll be stronger. So you can believe in whatever you believe. It doesn't matter that you know, call to be good, to be humble, to be generous, not just for yourself, but for the whole society. So stay here on the belly for another few rounds of breath, maybe 4 or 5. And if you notice that your mind is starting to get busy again, you're starting thinking, just come back to the breath. Come back to the sounds coming from the room or coming from the outside. There are always voices in your head trying to pull you out of your practice. So can you just push them aside for a little bit longer and tune deeper into your body? Into your breath, into your being. You know, I call it the holy grail of yoga, mind, body, and breath. And when they balance, then we feel stronger, we feel more put together. So from your belly, we'll make a transition into child's pose. So take again your blanket or your pillow, and you can either place it just in front of your knees and rest your heart on it. Another option is to bring it between your thighs and your shins. Again, maybe a block here to support your forehead. And if your knees are bothering you and this pose is not for you, stay on your baby and rest there. Try to bring your heart a little bit closer to the ground, so that sense of grounding matter how high you aim, always keep your feet on the ground to remember where you came from, and it's more not in the physical sense of it, but in the emotional or mental aspect of the practice. And try and send your breath now to the back of the body and to the side body. crowded space of stillness and silence. Breathing in and breathing out. Breathing in and breathing out. One breath in and one breath out. One breath in and one breath out. The challenge in this practice is being still. And be with yourself. And usually what happens, you know, when we are with ourselves, all kind of negative things start to come up. You know, if your mind wanders to places that are dark, you're not alone. That's what we tend to do. See if you can, you know, put it aside. And we, you know, we do tend to judge ourselves and beat ourselves for mistakes. Again, you are not alone in that. It's that what we do. So the mind, you know, it tells us stories about what could have happened, what may happen. It's just what it does. That's its tendency. And we cannot stop that process. We cannot stop thinking. But it's in our power, in our control, not to get carried away. So once we realize that this is what's going on, that this is what's happening, we can go back to the breath, go back to the physical body, to the senses, what we're hearing. What taste we have in the mouth, what are we smelling, the sensations against the skin, just to remind us that we are here, we are safe, we are in this room, in this position, and the mind tells us stories, but the reality is that
the physical body is safe.
Right, so we'll make a transition for our final pose. You can take just shavasana on the back. If you want to add some support, I like to have something under my lower back. You can bring the legs up the wall. You can bring the legs up a chair, or if you have a small coffee table next to you. So every time you lift the legs up, that gives them, especially the feet, a lot of rest. We do stand on the feet and work the legs most of the day. Not so much probably these days, because most of us sit more than we used to. But give your legs some break. The blood can drain down, and the feet can rest. So that's one option, to place the feet up the legs. Another option is to lie in shavasana. Again, maybe a little bit of a lift for the midsection of the body. Maybe you want to place a pillow under the head. Keep the neck a little bit longer. Close your eyes. And for the next 3 or 4 minutes, just be with your body. Be with your breath. If you can turn the lights off, go ahead and do so. Keep it simple. Keep it clear. Notice that you are in control. Once those thoughts are popping up again, let them be. Don't get involved. Don't get carried away. Tune back to the breath, to the physical body. Tune back to the senses. And create that space, create that the mind and the body and the breath meet. As long as they are balanced, you are safe. One breath at a time. In and out. I want to bring an official end to that practice
Maybe you want to stay in your shavasana a little bit longer. So stay where you are. If you need to, you know, go about your day, try to hold on to the sensation of peace and quiet. And keep in mind what we talked about today, and what kind of society you want to live. What are the things that are important to you? What you can what you can do to make yourself first and then the rest of the world a better place. And I know it's big words, and but this is a practice of yoga, this is a practice of every, you know, religion, I assume. So it doesn't matter if you are, you know, Christian or Jewish or Muslim or Hindu or Buddhist. I think it's in the essence of all of us. Be good, do good. Shabbat Shalom.